I'm Vicky Wheaton, thanks for joining me. I am here with the wonderful Kerri Kanuga, real estate agent by day and ultra marathoner by day and night. Kerri has raised so much money for different charities, and with this being the Christmas season of giving, we thought she would be an excellent choice, which is why we've talked her into wearing these beautiful antlers, and I am of course wearing this stunning chapeau. So Kerri, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
You're looking wonderful, I must say.
Thank you.
Well, you know, it comes from ages of doing that level of sport. So let's get started with a question. Have you always been sporty?
Yeah, I've always been sporty. In Canada, summers mostly, winters you tend to hibernate a little bit. I did ski, but I think my biggest sport in Canada was swimming. And also I played a lot of baseball as a child.
Okay. Swimming in Canada, yes. Definitely in the summer.
Yes, I learned how to swim in the lakes in Alberta, very cold.
Yeah.
And you know, you can't see further than a foot in front of your face. When I was about 12, they built a pool in my town and we definitely used that a lot. I was there every day.
Oh, very interesting. Okay, so you said you are an ultra marathoner.
Yes.
Which, I mean, most of us would go even a half normal marathon, which I think is about 13 miles. Is that correct?
13.1.
Yes, 13.1 miles. Yes, and the 0.1 makes a big difference when you're doing it. And then you've got the actual marathon, which is 26.2 miles. And then you kind of went, well, forget all of that. I'm going to go big or go home. Did you start just doing regular marathons or a half marathon?
I did. I never thought I'd do a marathon. And I think it was 2010 I did the Cayman Islands Marathon. And my head didn't fall off. I felt pretty good when I finished. So
You felt good when you finished?
I did. Okay. I did. So I'm like, okay, well, I wasn't expecting to. And so I thought, well, what's next? Then I think the next longest event I did was the Ken Chris's event, Off the Beaten Track.
Yes.
That's a fun one.
Is it? I'm sure it's a fun one for people who are fit. I've written articles about it, and it sounds like that is quite the journey, because for those people who don't know, the Off the Beaten Track really is off the beaten track. They actually are cutting down bush and marking a path through it, and it takes people through some interesting terrain.
Yeah, places you wouldn't normally go in Cayman, which is nice. You get to see all of it, literally.
My eyes would be clouding over. I wouldn't be seeing it. So wow, okay, so you did that one.
Yeah.
And you thought, well, this is wonderful.
Yeah, and I was still doing quite a bit of swimming at the time, so I did want to run a 100-mile race. So I earmarked, it's called the Keys 100, so it goes from, I think it's Key Largo to Key West. And I trained up for that 1 year and I ended up, I broke a bone in my foot. So I then decided, well, I can't run right now, so let's do some swimming. So that year I swam around Key West. And then I had my sights set again on doing this 100-mile race again the next year. And gosh, what did I do to myself? I think I broke my toe. And it wasn't running related, that one, but I wasn't able to heal on time, and I was still quite swim fit, still quite run fit. So for my birthday that year, I swam across the Sound and then I ran around the island twice.
Like everybody does for their birthday.
Yes, one does.
And then one has cake.
Lots of cake. But that year I ran the charity that I ran for was St. Baldrick's.
Right.
And we raised quite a bit of money for them, which I was pleased.
Yeah, now I know that you have raised a lot of money for charity over the years. So is St. Baldrick's your main charity?
It's one of them. I support a few charities. The other local charity that I've been raising funds for recently are Canine Friends. And so they basically rescue dogs from, a facility here, the government facility, and try to rehome them. Often they're able to find homes for them overseas. So November, I was part of a rescue where we took some dogs. I met them in Miami and we drove from Miami to New York. And so I was able to use my ultra skills then, because I think I drove straight for about 17 hours. The trip was 21 hours or so. So it was...
It was a lot of fun. It was like
whether you're driving.
We had 12 dogs in the car with us. And
did you have the van though? Because that's the important thing with Dumb and Dumber, is having that van with the floppy ears.
Well, it was a big van, but no floppy ears.
It's a quality film, Dumb and Dumber. Quality. Have you ever gone in for, and I'm going to ask you about some of the other ultramarathons you've done, because they sound bonkers. And it occurred to me that the early ones that you would have done on Grand Cayman and the Keys would all be very flat areas, yes. Which is useful even for those of us who don't run. Have you ever got into a marathon and gone, this was a mistake, why did I ever agree to do this?
Every time. Every time I run. You know, it's hard to start, but once you get there, once you start getting in the flow of it, you just lose time, and it's not as bad as anybody thinks. Mm-hmm. It really is.
I'm going to remember these words.
Absolutely. You know, and anytime I don't want to do a workout or anything, or, you know, whatever it is that day, I'll say, just do it for 10 minutes. I can do anything for 10 minutes. Mm-hmm. And if I want to stop after 10 minutes. And, you know, I've been doing this for quite a while now, and I've never stopped after 10 minutes.
Have you done anything like the Boston Marathon or the New York Marathon, London Marathon?
I would love to, but I'm not a marathoner. I'm not fast. I usually don't catch up to people till about mile 40, mile 60. Mm-hmm. I'm way in the back. And then my skill is endurance. So, you know, when these people are finally starting to get a little bit tired or stop, that's when I start to pass people. I'm a constant speed throughout.
I was talking to somebody who had done, I think it was the New York Marathon, and they were saying that once you've done the 26.2 miles, you get to the finish line, you can't just sort of stop where you are. You can't just stop and go, thank goodness that's over. You've almost got to go another mile because there are so many other people around you and behind you basically pushing you. You can't sort of just drop where you are and go, ha, done. You've really got to keep moving. I think that last mile would be what would kill me.
Yeah, well, and that's
unusual. You know, some of these races sometimes are a little bit longer than you thought. And it's like, just when you think you're done, or there'll be a fake finish point. And sometimes race directors have a really bad sense of humor where they'll make you do a mile out and come back to the official finish. You know, you'll see it, but it'll be the fake finish. Anyways,
it's, these race directors can't live very long.
Summer cruel.
What is the most bonkers ultramarathon you've ever done?
Well, the most bonkers and my favorite is the Badwater 135. So I've been fortunate enough to have completed it four times. The only thing harder than the marathon is actually to get into it. There's usually about 2,000 qualified individuals a year that apply for it. So to qualify, you have to have completed at least three races of 100 miles or more. And there's about a 5-page application you have to fill out, and there's only 100 spots. So there's actually a panel that goes through all of the applications, and they choose the 100 people to participate. The race itself starts in a place, it's the Badwater Basin, which is the lowest point in North America, which is 311 feet below sea level. And it goes through Death Valley, which is the hottest place on Earth.
Yes.
And that's in July, so the hottest time of the year, over three mountain ranges, and it finishes at the porthole of Mount Whitney.
So not flat?
Not flat.
Not flat, that one.
Not flat at all.
People are clamoring to participate in that one.
Yes. So I was lucky enough, actually, this year to be chosen for my fifth, but unfortunately, due to COVID, it was postponed till next year.
Right.
So.
In all your experience, because you are now very experienced, and I love how you say, oh, I'm not a marathoner. You are. What are essential items that you've, because people I think would immediately, if they thought about running a marathon, they would go, well, I have to have really good shoes, I have to have, you know, water, whatever. Are there items that people wouldn't think of that you have realized over time are absolutely vital, particularly for the ultra marathons?
Well, I'm usually spoiled. A lot of my ultras, I'll have a crew, but some I do not. So I have to actually carry what I need on my back. And the things that I would not go without, toilet paper, salt tabs, and basically electrolytes. You really have to be careful, I think, as far as what you put in. You have to be very careful with your stomach, because a lot of people really suffer and often have to drop out because they just, you know, you can really upset your stomach. Like, it's terrible. Uncommon to get sick in during an event, so you know you also have to have something to calm that. So maybe some ginger.
Okay, and you said a crew, so you might have a crew with you.
Yeah.
How many people is that, and what do they do? I mean, they obviously don't run. She said they don't run beside you. I'm assuming how does the whole crew thing work?
Depending on the race, for example, Badwater, for the first 40 miles, I cannot have anybody run with me, but after that, I can have a pacer. A crew, for example, Badwater, you know, death is an option out there. If you don't have a crew with you, you will perish. You have to have someone there to replenish water, food, things like that. And so that's basically what they do. You know, sometimes I feel like a bridezilla, because if my crew come running to me, it's like, what do you want? And it's like, oh no, I don't want barbecue Pringles, I want salt and vinegar.
Leave me alone.
Yeah, and you know, sometimes when you're 28 hours into an event, you it does matter.
Oh, I mean, when I used to go to the gym, and I'd be in the middle of some reps, and I'd decide up the weight, and I mean, the muscles are hurting. I think even just somebody comes and says hi.
Oh yeah.
It's the final straw.
Yeah.
So I can imagine it. How do you choose your crew?
Believe it or not, friends, and sometimes they're still friends after.
Okay.
Yeah. So, and other ultra marathoners, you know, it's a very giving community. It's a very small community, and you know, when I'm overseas, I just like to be part of an event. So I'm very happy to help out and give back that way.
Any exotic locales that you've run in?
Oh, I've been lucky. I've seen places in the world I would have never have seen. I've been to China. I've been to Morocco. Brazil a couple of times, I couldn't be happier. I was actually in Brazil this January, was the last race I did. It was a 135 mile mountain race, and I came in third overall, female, which I'm very proud of.
So you're faster than you think.
Yeah.
I'm like so humble. Not really a marathoner. I do 135 miles, but you know, not really a marathoner. How long do you normally have to do that kind of distance?
I can do 100 miles in about 22 hours or so, I think is the
same
fastest.
Day.
Yeah.
Got it.
And I think the fastest Badwater I've done is just over 36, so.
Okay. I was going to say to you, because being an idiot, or a marathoner idiot, let's just specify, I had assumed that one would run for a certain period of time. One would sleep overnight in a catered tent with beautiful lights and soft music, and then one would rise again at a decent hour and run the remainder. Obviously, that's not the case. What is the longest period then you've basically kept moving? Is it the 36 hours?
No. The longest race I've ever completed is the Tahoe 200. It's actually 205. You see where this goes? They call it the 200, but it's 205.
Yeah, those race directors.
Yeah.
What a wacky bunch.
It was a mountain race, so very hard to train for in Cayman, as I'm sure you can imagine. And it was also, it wasn't on road, it was obviously trails. So another very hard thing to train for in Cayman. And I had 100 hours to finish the race, and I did it in 99 and a little. So I did make the cutoff, but it was a race, you know, you're just so tired sometimes, you just lie down in dirt, and you're out immediately.
Word. That part lot I'm familiar with.
And then in Morocco, it's very funny. I was telling somebody the story the other day. You know, we're out there. We're in the middle of the desert. We're basically sleeping under a tarp and everything else. And this was a staged race, like you said, where you do run a certain amount, and then you have the night, and then you run again the next day. So I was out there for, I think we were out there for about 7 days, and for me it was like a little holiday, because it was like, oh, I get to get up in the morning and run, and then I sleep, and I've got all these friends with similar interests around me. I was so excited and happy. I actually put on weight, because you have to carry everything in, and you take out all your garbage and everything else, but if somebody does not finish a meal, you're, you know, it's considered garbage, so you can eat it. So my friends, they had stomach issues and stuff like that. I was just having the greatest time, so I'm eating. And, you know, they're all starting to lose weight and look like bobbleheads. Anyway, we got out of the desert, and we stayed in this beautiful hotel that Brad Pitt had stayed in recently. And so it was just kind of like from sleeping in the dirt to this swoosh.
Fantastic.
Yeah, yeah. So, again, someplace I would have never have gone if I hadn't had the sporting community that I travel with, so.
Yeah, and you must have met a lot of people over the years. I mean, I presume people that you keep in contact with. But,
yeah, you know, you show up to these races and you always know someone, which is lovely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, nice community. No, I mean, I don't know. I'm so keen to be part of the community that I'll start this. I don't know. You're going to see me at a half marathon and I'll be like, Kerri, you lied to the bug is correct. With stomach issues, right? Sometimes, you said stomach. Yes. Any funny or like, okay, any terrifying moment that in a marathon you've done?
Yeah, because you do get tired, you do get sleep deprived, and you know there have been some where I don't have a crew that's, you know, kind of watching out for me. So I was in the race I did in China. I woke up a couple of times, kind of on a cliff edge. You know, I was sleeping on my feet, but, you know, so there's a little bit of your, I guess your subconscious is still awake enough not to to stumble over. You know, when I fully awake, it's like, whoa. So there was a couple moments in that race for that one. Yeah, I've fallen asleep on a trail where I'll be at a T intersection. I don't know if I should go left or right. Hallucinations, those are always good. I was actually Tahoe. I got to a place where I thought there should be a rest stop, and I swear there were. I was talking to people. I had, you know, I was handing them my water bottles to fill up. I was ordering my breakfast burrito, and I thought they were being quite rude because they were ignoring me. And a few minutes later, I figured out that they were trees. So standing there talking to trees for about 5 minutes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So marathons and. Drinking a big night out, kind of similar, really. when it comes to it, approximately how much money? I'm putting you on the spot a bit. I know I'm putting you on the spot a bit for this because I didn't warn you I was going to ask the question. Approximately, have you any idea how much money you've raised for charities since you've been doing this?
Oh, good. No, it's a bit of a bouncing ball, and depending, easily over 100,000, which is,
yeah, easily. You know. No, it's amazing. It's fantastic. Yeah, I mean, what you've given has been incredible. And I mean, you give it with such a full heart. I always see your picture in our newspaper, hear about you on the news, because you are doing all of these different things for charity. Your most recent one was swimming. Okay, so remind me, where did you swim from and to for that one?
Well, I was a little bit tired of running the island with COVID, so I thought I'd get back in the water, and it was fabulous. No one had ever swam, well, I call it the hard way. So when you think about swimming the Sound, you'll usually swim from Rum Point side this way because you're with the current, with the wind. So I thought what I would do is start from Barker's and swim to Starfish Point, so against the current, against the wind, all against the waves. So I made it there, and then I continued on and swam to Kamana Bay. So it was about 20 kilometers.
And how long did that take?
8 hours and 38 minutes, I think it was.
And how did you feel at the end of that?
Pretty good, actually. I was happy. You know, I had a lot of people come out and see me land, so... Yeah.
That's always nice, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, I think, again, and this is completely from the observation point of view, it's certainly not from doing it, it seems that at these marathons, when you do have people lining the streets and they're cheering you on, that's got to be a big boost. Yeah. That it's got to be so nice to have that. It,
it must be a little bit more difficult to do a sort of solitary thing where you're feeling a bit more alone.
It's always nice to have. I know one of the first things I ever did was the half marathon in Bermuda. And I used to write little notes about, you know, my experience. And I remember reading that one and it said, my cheeks hurt. And it was these cheeks from smiling so much.
Yeah, no, that's nice. It's lovely to have the support. Final question. Somebody's going to start getting into running, and I'm talking about from earlier. I'm not talking about just getting straight into marathons or anything. But if somebody wants to start building up the resistance or see if they're able to do a marathon, how would you suggest that they start that?
Well, there's lots of great programs or schedules online that you can Google. So what I like to do is have someone, I have a coach that sets my agenda for the week. So, you know, if it's written down someplace and you know what you need to do, you're more likely to do it versus, I don't feel like running today. Mm-hmm. I'll run tomorrow. But it's the whole 10-minute trick. You know,
you
get out there
10
and, keep going. If you feel like it, if you don't, go home. But I promise you, you're stronger than you think.
Oh, it's fantastic. Well, Kerri, thank you so much for joining us. It's been absolutely fascinating. Oh, what's your next? Do you have another one lined up yet?
Well, I was hoping to do a winter event where it's called the Arrowhead 135. And basically, it's in Minnesota. Mm-hmm. So it's going to be Canada cold up there, 40 below-ish. Mm-hmm. It's no one to get to. It's through the wilderness. It's self-supported. And I would be pulling my supplies, my water, my food itself on a sled behind me. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, due to COVID restrictions and travel.
Unfortunately, you can't go to the bitter cold, pull a toboggan of necessary supplies behind you, and be running in a dry suit. Well, hopefully the disappointment doesn't last for too long, and you'll get to be back on that horse pretty soon. Well, thank you again so much, Kerri. Lovely being with you. Thank you for wearing, you know, the antlers. It added. This is all added.
I haven't seen them yet, so hopefully.
Well, they look stunning on you. Take my word for it. Anyway, everybody, enjoy a festive season. Don't forget, it is the season of giving. I said just like this lovely young lady opposite me, it's all about the generosity at this time of the year. Thank you.